The following is an EWTN special presentation.
EWTN's Cathedrals Across America presents... From the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception in Portland, Maine, the massive installation of the Most Reverend Robert P. Deeley as the 12th Bishop of Portland.
Good day and welcome to the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception in Portland, Maine. I'm Father Reed, and you're watching the installation mass for the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland, Bishop Designate Robert Deeley. It's been a wintry couple of days here in New England and up the eastern coast, but the snow has finally stopped here in Portland, and a sizable crowd of the good people of this great diocese, the priests, the deacons, the religious, Cardinal Sean O'Malley, the Metropolitan Archbishop of Boston, the Diocese of Portland falling into that metropolitan region for which Cardinal Sean has responsibility, is present here today. The Apostolic Nuncio, Archbishop Vigano. Also, many of Bishop Deeley's priest friends, bishop friends, and of course, his dear family with whom he is so very close. In fact, I'm very conscious of the fact that many of Bishop Deeley's family in Ireland are watching this live broadcast and webcast at this very moment. Welcome to you all. Welcome to our viewers and listeners on the Eternal Word Television Network, the Catholic TV Network, the Presence Radio Network, and online at the website for the Diocese of Portland, portlanddiocese.net. Many, many thanks to WMTW TV Channel 8 here in Portland for providing the satellite uplink to allow all of us to join in this solemn and historical moment in the life of the Church of the Diocese of Portland and Maine. A very special and personal thanks to Dave Guthrow, who is the communications director here in the diocese, for his generous assistance in making this broadcast possible for you, and to Headlight Audio Video of Portland, who have provided the technology and the great staff so that we can make it possible for you to almost be here at the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception in Portland, Maine. You're looking at live scenes of the entrance procession, some of the Knights of Malta and Knights of Columbus taking up their place in this beautiful cathedral church. The installation of the bishop of a diocese is a simple but deeply meaningful ritual. The rite begins literally at the doors of the cathedral church. And as I mentioned, so many priests of the Diocese of Portland and priest friends of Bishop Deeley are present here to concelebrate this Mass with him today. Welcome to the installation Mass for the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland and Maine, Bishop Robert Deeley.
Thank you.
The music for today's installation mass is being provided by the Cathedral Choir of the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception here in Portland, augmented by members of parish choirs from throughout this great diocese, which, by the way, encompasses the entire state of Maine. The rite of installation, as I mentioned, begins literally at the doors of the cathedral church, this church that will be Bishop Deeley's church and what is the mother church for the good people of this diocese. Bishop Deeley's predecessor, Bishop Richard Malone, will greet his successor at the door and welcome him. And the rector of the cathedral, Father Lou Phillips, will then present to Bishop Deeley a crucifix, which the bishop designate will reverence with the kiss customary to this ritual. The bishop then will sprinkle the people crowded here into the cathedral with holy water. In this act, we recall our baptism, our entrance into the church, which is the body of Christ. You're watching live scenes of the entrance procession for the installation mass for the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland, Bishop Robert Deeley. The rite of canonical possession, the installation of a new bishop, also includes the reading of the apostolic mandate. That is the document signed by Pope Francis himself, appointing Bishop Deeley as the 12th ordinary of this great diocese. It's sometimes referred to as a papal bull, named after the lead seal in Latin, bulla, that is appended to the document in order to authenticated. That document will be read most appropriately by Archbishop Carlo Maria Vigano, the Apostolic Nuncio, that is the Pope's representative to the people in the diocese and the bishops of the United States of America.
Come, Holy Spirit. From heaven shine forth with your glorious light. Veni Sancte Spiritus.
Veni Sancte Spiritus.
Come, Father of the poor, come, generous Spirit, come, light of our lives, Veni Sancte Spiritus.
Veni Sancte.
The cathedral choir sings the Taizé, Veni Sancte Spiritus. Come, Holy Spirit. And we pray that the Holy Spirit would fill this cathedral church with his grace and light and peace at this moment of new beginning on the journey of faith for the people of the Diocese of Portland. Installation ritual is the chair or the cathedra, the bishop's chair. And as part of the rite of canonical possession, after the apostolic mandate has been read and witnessed, Bishop Deeley will be seated in the chair and handed the crozier, the shepherd's staff. That crozier and that chair that you can see here just behind the altar is a reminder to all of us of the authority that is given to Bishop Deeley this day in his appointment by the Pope to shepherd, to guide, to govern, and to sanctify the people of this Diocese of Portland. Over 100 priests and 11 transitional deacons present here for this liturgy of installation today. And we're preparing now for the beginning of the rite of canonical possession. Again, that rite begins at the doors of the church. Bishop Richard Malone will greet Bishop Deeley at the doors. And then Bishop Deeley will kiss the image of Christ crucified and sprinkle those of us gathered here in the cathedral with holy water, recalling our baptism. You're watching live coverage of the installation mass of the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland. We welcome our viewers on the Eternal Word Television Network, the Catholic TV Network, the Presence Radio Network, and online at the website for the Diocese of Portland, portlanddiocese.net. The cathedral church of any diocese is considered the bishop's church. As I mentioned briefly, it is where his cathedra or chair is located, hence the name cathedral. The cathedral not only symbolizes a part of the church, but also it represents the whole church. So said Blessed John Paul II. This particular cathedral of the Immaculate Conception was dedicated on the 8th of September, 1869. But work on it actually began more than a decade earlier. Shortly after the diocese was established in 1855, Bishop Bacon, the first bishop of Portland, began acquiring land for it. The adjoining chapel, in which I am now standing, was completed in December, 1856, but work on the cathedral itself was delayed because of a supply shortage during the Civil War. Less than 2 months after construction began, with the walls mostly completed, the great fire of the 4th of July, 1866, swept through the city of Portland, destroying not only the new cathedral, but the chapel, the parish school, a convent, and the bishop's residence. Bishop Bacon would write in his diary, "Nothing of value was saved." And it would lead the bishop to go on a fundraising tour throughout the Northeast and into Canada to raise the necessary money so as to rebuild. It will be the crozier that Bishop Bacon once carried that will be handed today to Bishop Deeley as part of this rite of canonical possession. Work began again, and the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception was dedicated on the 8th of September, 1869, but it was worth the wait. As you can see, this Gothic Revival style church features vaulted ceilings, strong vertical lines, soaring spires, lancet-shaped windows. Like many churches in the Northeast, this cathedral was designed by Patrick Charles Keeley of New York, one of the most prominent architects of Catholic churches in the United States at that time. The cathedral's organ that you hear playing right now also dates back to 1869, having been built by the prestigious Henry Urban Company of New York. The organ has an astounding 3,369 pipes, and you will perhaps hear each one of those pipes at this joyous celebration today. You know, through the years, bishops leave their mark on their cathedral church. In the early 1900s, Bishop William O'Connell commissioned these incredibly beautiful stained glass windows. We'll give you a chance to look at those now, just a bit. They depict events in the life of Jesus Christ and His Blessed Mother. Scenes such as this, the Immaculate Conception and the Assumption, the Nativity of the Lord, the Miracle of Cana, the death of Saint Joseph, the crucifixion, and many others. That striking window of the Immaculate Conception behind the sanctuary was a gift of Bishop O'Connell himself to the church. Bishop Walsh also commissioned an elaborate baptismal font crafted by an eminent Italian artisan. Atop that font is a statue of the risen Christ, which is a replica of one fashioned by Michelangelo. Around the walls of this Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception are the Stations of the Cross, as is traditional in most Catholic churches. They are handcrafted out of 6,000 quarter-inch pieces of Venetian glass with gold leaf facings. They were installed in 1930 during the episcopacy of Bishop John Murray. You can see one of the stations there, Jesus carrying the cross. As I mentioned, the beautiful pieces of Venetian glass with gold leaf facings. You see there members of the choir and another one of the very beautiful stained glass windows that bring light and color to this cathedral church. Although there have been many changes and additions through the years, this 145-year-old cathedral appears much today as it did for its 50th Jubilee celebration. A millennium restoration project undertaken under the direction of Father Jim Nadeau, a contemporary of mine from the North American College, who was then rector, and Bishop Joseph Gerry, and Monsignor Mark Caron helped preserve, uncover, and better showcase the many treasures of the cathedral. The cathedral is actually listed in the National Register of Historic Places. And from the tip of its 200-foot steeple to the crypt beneath the floor, history surrounds those who gather here today for this installation mass. I'm Father Reed, and you're watching live coverage of the installation of Bishop-designate Robert Deeley from the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception on the Eternal Word Television Network, the Catholic TV Network, the Presence Radio Network, and online at the website for the Diocese of Portland. You know, there's a lot to admire in this Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception, but its greatest attribute is not in its architecture or artistry, but rather in the people, the priests, the religious, who sit here today. It's the mystery that is celebrated here, not the majesty, that matters the very most. Blessed John Paul II, who will soon be canonized, once wrote that the cathedral should be seen as the center of the diocese life. And those simple words are made manifest in our presence today. This is a church that belongs to all of the people of the Diocese of Portland, of the entire state of Maine. And everyone is welcome here. On the occasion of the cathedral's 125th anniversary, Bishop Joseph Gary, the Bishop Emeritus, wrote that this church is a special and unique sign of the unity of all of Maine's Catholics, gathered together with their bishop in a common faith. As we wait for the beginning of the rite of canonical possession, which commences the beginning of this installation mass, just a few interesting facts. There are two bishops buried here, Bishop David Bacon, the first Bishop of Portland, and Bishop Lewis Walsh, who was the fourth Bishop of Portland. They're both buried in the crypt. And on the day of his appointment, Bishop Deeley came here to the cathedral and visited and prayed at the graves of both Bishop Bacon and Bishop Walsh. Back in 1869, on the evening of the dedication of the cathedral, there was a storm with very high winds, which caused the cathedral steeple to break from its foundation and topple down against a house that was across the street. Fortunately, there were no injuries. And fortunately for us, a stronger steeple has been built. You can see there on our live picture the altar, the present altar of sacrifice, that and the ambo from which the scripture readings are proclaimed were made out of marble from the now closed St. Dominic Church in Portland. Very fitting, because not only was it the first Catholic church in the city of Portland, but it was the church that served as pro-cathedral for the installation of Bishop Bacon. The cathedral originally seated more than 900. But that has been reduced to about 760. However, with additional seating, we estimate there are about 1,100 people gathered here today for this liturgy of installation. What is a bishop, you might ask? A bishop oversees the ministerial and administrative life of a diocese. A diocese which is made up of local communities, parishes of the faithful. The bishop acts as a father to the good people, a brother to the priests in his diocese. He also serves as the local spiritual leader for all of the faithful with his care. The bishop oversees a diocese. The word diocese comes from a Greek word meaning to keep house. So Bishop Deeley, beginning today, will be keeping house here in Portland, a task that Bishop Richard Malone has done so well for so many years. A bishop is regarded by those of us in the Catholic community as a true shepherd, a successor of the apostles, whom Jesus Christ chooses to carry on the work of his church, to carry on the good work of the new evangelization. The very nature of the office of a bishop is to be a teacher of the faith. And that teaching is grounded in God's holy word as it has been preserved and handed on to us in sacred scripture and in the sacred tradition of the church, so that the bishop, along with those with whom he collaborates, continue to invite people to salvation by believing, accepting, and living the divinely revealed truth. You see, Cardinal Sean O'Malley, the Metropolitan Archbishop of Boston, entering the Cathedral Church now, he will be the principal celebrant up until the point when Bishop Deeley is seated in the cathedra or the bishop's chair. You're watching live coverage of the rite of installation of the 12th Bishop of Portland. I'm Father Reed. Thank you to all those who are watching and viewing on the Eternal Word Television Network, the Catholic TV Network, the Presence Radio Network, and online wherever you might be. The procession is led by the image of Jesus Christ, who died for each one of us on the wood of the cross. And the beautiful music being provided by the Cathedral Choir here at the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception and some members of parish choirs from throughout the Diocese of Portland. Now witness the beginning of the simple but very meaningful installation rite for Bishop Deeley. You see Bishop Malone waiting to greet him as he comes through the main doors of the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception. Bishop Deeley knocks, and his predecessor opens the doors to welcome him to the cathedral for the first time. Bishop Deeley now will be presented with a crucifix, which he will reverence with a kiss. And then in sprinkling those of us gathered here in the cathedral and himself with holy water, we recall our baptism when each one of us came into the church, which is the body of Christ. watching live scenes of the beginning of the rite of canonical possession from the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception in Portland. God has blessed us here in Portland with fine weather today. The snow has stopped, the wind has calmed down, and the skies have brightened. And we join our voices now in the opening hymn for this installation mass led by the Cathedral Choir. Come, host of heaven's high dwelling. Just behind Bishop Deeley, his brother, Father Kevin Deeley, and his good friend, Monsignor William Fay, acting as his chaplains today for this mass of installation. As each of the priests, bishops, and Bishop Designate Deeley himself approaches the altar, they reverence the altar with a kiss. The altar, consecrated, reminds us of Christ's true presence here in our midst as we gather for the celebration of Mass. And Cardinal Sean O'Malley himself reverences the altar with a kiss. And so on this solemn occasion, Cardinal Sean will incense the altar and likewise reverence the image of Christ crucified with the incense. Bishop Deeley served with Cardinal Sean as Vicar General and moderator of the Curia in the Archdiocese of Boston. But his presence here today, Cardinal Sean's presence, is indicative as well of his responsibility as the Metropolitan Archbishop. The Diocese of Portland falls within the metropolitan region over which Cardinal Sean has some responsibility. So in a sense, Bishop Deeley and Cardinal Sean will continue to work together for the good of the church here in the Diocese of Portland. You see, directly to the left of Bishop Deeley, his brother Kevin, Father Kevin Deeley, and Monsignor William Fay, his two chaplains. We glory, And so the Cardinal begins this Mass with the sign of the cross.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Please be seated.
We make our own the words of Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. As I stand in this cathedral ambo for my final official duty as the 11th bishop and recently apostolic administrator of this blessed diocese of Portland, I have the very happy privilege of extending a warm and hearty welcome to you all. Cardinal Sean, our Metropolitan Archbishop, Archbishop Vigano, our nuncio and personal representative of our Holy Father Pope Francis, my brother bishops, priests, deacons, religious, lay faithful, and family and friends of our new bishop, you are so very welcome here. And to you, Bishop Deeley, let me simply say that we thank you and we thank God for your Episcopal ministry, and we thank our Holy Father Francis for sending you here as the 12th Bishop of Portland. God's people in Maine are grateful, and so am I. This diocese, the entire state of Maine, all 33,215 square miles of it, was founded in 1853 by Pope Pius IX, then comprising New Hampshire as well as Maine, in case you didn't know that little factoid. Imagine. The origins of the Catholic community here date much earlier, though, to the year 1604, when a group of 80 French Catholics and Protestants arrived on the tiny island of what is now called St. Croix, not far from present-day Calais. Very soon, missionary activity began, what I like to call the first wave of evangelization, and that wave continued in the midst of conflicts back then between England and France over control of the region, difficult times in which the faith was first planted and began to grow. In a climate of anti-Catholic prejudice fed by the Know-Nothing movement, Father Henry Coscary, Vicar General of Baltimore, declined appointment in 1853 as First Bishop of Portland. In 1855, David W. Bacon of Brooklyn, Portland's first bishop, arrived in Portland under cover of darkness, dressed as a layman to avoid a riot. Well, while there still are challenges to the faith in the secular environment of northern New England, we are so grateful, Bishop Deeley, that you came to us in the daylight, not to a riot, but to the enthusiastic welcome of Maine's faithful Catholic people. As you are presented today with the crozier of Portland's first bishop, Bishop Bacon, know that the diocese has come a long way and that you have the prayers of all of us as you continue the journey of the new evangelization upon which the diocese has resolutely embarked. We welcome you today as a bishop with rich pastoral and administrative experience, as a shepherd in the words of 2 Timothy, strong, loving, and wise. Finally, on a personal note, as I conclude my pastoral ministry here in Maine, I extend my sincere thanks to the thousands of good people, clergy, religious, lay faithful, young folks and old, who welcomed me and walked the path of faith and mission with me these years. It has been an honor to be among you all. God bless you. Please pray for me as I shall for you. And if ever you're traveling up to Niagara Falls, drop by in Buffalo for coffee. My office is but a half hour away. God bless you all.
Bishop Richard Malone, who was the 11th Bishop of Portland, an apostolic administrator in these days of transition, now the Bishop of Buffalo, happily welcoming Bishop Deeley and saying farewell to the people of this good diocese.
My dear brothers and sisters in the Lord, it's a great joy to be here once again as your Metropolitan. This is the second time I've had this privilege to be in the beautiful Cathedral of Portland to install a bishop for this local church. And in both occasions, they have been men whom I know very well and admire, men of great pastoral zeal, talent, and personal sanctity. And I know that once again, you will have a very fine bishop here in Portland, and it's wonderful to be a part of this celebration. Our Holy Father is in Rome today with 20,000 engaged couples celebrating St. Valentine's Day with the theme, Joy of Yes Forever. We are celebrating St. Valentine's Day with the installation of a new bishop, an event that Archbishop Chaput likened to an arranged marriage. So it's very fitting to be doing it on this feast day. We are here to celebrate this moment of renewal that comes about when the gift of apostolic succession gives a local community a priest in the chain of succession from the apostles. The ministry of the bishop is to make the pastoral love of the Good Shepherd present to God's people. At the first Eucharist and ordination ceremony, Jesus washes the feet of his disciples and gives us the new commandment that we love each other the way that Jesus loves us. The bishop has the formidable task of promoting that love and unity of Christ's followers so that we can witness to the presence of the risen Lord in our midst. Pope Francis is ever reminding us that we must all work together to bring Christ's love to all, especially those who are poor and suffering. Christ has entrusted this mission to us. It's now our mission to be joyful ministers of the gospel, to be a force for reconciliation and solidarity in a world fraught with divisions and fractionalized by individualism and competition. Our desire must be to be humble and joyful servants of the gospel. We can only do that together. An installation of a new bishop is a moment to recommit to Christ, to his church, and to the mission that the Lord has entrusted to us. We are delighted today to have with us our Apostolic Nuncio, Archbishop Carlo Maria Vigano. Recently, Bishop Motano was installed as the Bishop of Rochester, and Cardinal Dolan and myself both tried to get there. Cardinal Dolan is actually his Metropolitan, but due to the weather, we were unable to make it to Rochester. However, Archbishop Vigano was there, and he's with us today. I think we could write on the nunciature the motto of the U.S. Postal Service, neither snow nor rain nor heat nor gloom of night stays these couriers from the swift completion of their appointed rounds. Archbishop Vigano, welcome. God bless you. Assure our love to our Holy Father.
Cardinal Sean O'Malley, the Archbishop of Boston, the Metropolitan Archbishop, never without a humorous but a teaching word, calling to mind that the appointment of a bishop can be likened to an arranged marriage, but certainly for all of us, a time to recommit to the new evangelization. We now move to the reading of the apostolic mandate. Archbishop Vigano, the apostolic nuncio.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I want first of all to thank His Eminence Cardinal Sean for the word that he has addressed to me. Bishop Malone, you mentioned that the first bishop arrived during the night. I did yesterday, but from some other reasons, as you may imagine. And I think I did in some way better than when I was not able to arrive in time in Buffalo for your installation. So today is the Feast of St. Valentine, and we heard how the Holy Father has been celebrating this morning with a huge number of fiancés. But also today is the memorial day of St. Cyril and St. Methodius, that especially for many or some of you who are coming from the Central and Eastern Europe, is reminding those great apostles. And in the word of Pope John Paul II, they were the spiritual bridge between Eastern and Western tradition. The people of God in Portland, Maine, rejoice today in this particular feast, as Bishop Robert Peter Deeley is solemnly installed as the 12th bishop of this local church. In less than 1 month, our Holy Father, Pope Francis, will have completed the first year of his pontificate. During his homily at the Holy Mass with his cardinal electors on the March 14th in the Sistine Chapel, Pope Francis used three words to point out the constant movement of the Church: ambulare, to journey; edificare, to build; confiteri, to profess. And expressed the following concluding sentiment: my wish is that all of us, after these days of grace, will have the courage, yes, the courage, to walk in the presence of the Lord with the Lord's cross, to build the church on the Lord's blood, which was poured out on the cross, and to profess the one glory, Christ crucified. And in this way, the church will go forward. Bishop Deeley, we are confident that as you begin your ministry to the clergy, religious and faithful, being entrusted to your pastoral care here in the Diocese of Portland, you will show that courage called by our Holy Father as you journey together with your flock in the light of the Lord, as you build the church with the stones of the Holy Spirit, and as you profess Jesus Christ and Him crucified to the spiritual betterment of this beloved family of faith and society at large. At this time, I would like to thank in a special way His Excellency Sir Richard Malone for his years of dedication as the 11th Bishop of Portland, and for his valuable collaboration more recently as Apostolic Administrator. I will now read for you the Apostolic Letter of Appointment. Francis, Bishop, servant of the servants of God. To our venerable brother, Robert Peter Deeley, until now Auxiliary Bishop of Boston and titular Bishop of Kearney, at this time appointed Bishop of Portland. Greetings and apostolic blessing. So that his disciples might live the truth in love, the Lord Jesus enriched the church with a wide diversity of ministries, among which is regarded of singular importance the apostolate of bishops, through which the people of God are sanctified, governed, and taught. For this reason, it is not without great care that we direct our attention to the state of Maine, which is named the Pine Tree State, and which comprises the Diocese of Portland, currently a vacancy owing to the transfer of his previous shepherd, Richard Joseph Malone, to the church in Buffalo. Indeed, in our judgment, you, venerable brother, are clearly endowed with the virtues and qualities of character which render you capable of undertaking this important responsibility. Therefore, upon consultation with the Congregation for Bishops, by virtue of the fullness of our apostolic authority, by this letter, we release you from the bond of the titular Church of Kearney and the office of Auxiliary of Boston, and we name and we appoint you Bishop of Portland. You will accordingly duly inform the clergy and the people of your diocese about this your appointment. And we in turn exhort them not only to honor you with heartfelt filial devotion, but also to comply with the just instructions which you will have given in your zealous ministry. In the meantime, venerable brother, it is our earnest desire that, aware of the important office being entrusted to you, you always raise your eyes to the most blessed Virgin Mary, conceived without sin, through whose intercession we know for sure that you will greatly devote yourself to the spiritual edification and well-being of your flock. For she, who is the patroness not only of the nation, but also of your diocese, will bring you assistance. For now, we accompany you in your weighty episcopal office, sustaining you by our prayers, so that your new ministry on behalf of Christ and his church may attain as fruitful an outcome as possible. Given at Rome, at St. Peter's, on the 88th day of the month of December, in the year of the Lord 2013, the first of our pontificate, Francis, our Pope.
Archbishop Carlo Maria Vigano, reading the apostolic mandate, which he now hands to Sister Rita Mae Bissonette, who is the Chancellor of the Diocese of Portland. Sister Rita Mae Bissonette is a sister of Our Lady of the Holy Rosary. Assembling now in the sanctuary are the members of the College of Consultors. And Sister shows the apostolic mandate to each of the members of the college. The College of Consultors is an institute established by canon law and presided over by the bishop of a diocese. They provide counsel to the bishop on matters of pastoral concern. And so Sister Marie Bissonette shows the apostolic mandate to all of us gathered here in the cathedral. sometimes referred to as a papal bull. The apostolic mandate contains the lead seal or bulla, proving its authenticity. Cardinal Sean now hands the crozier, which is actually the crozier of the first bishop of Portland, Bishop Bacon. And he and Archbishop Vigano escort Bishop Deeley to the cathedra, or the bishop's chair. And as Bishop Deeley sits in the chair, he becomes the 12th bishop of the Diocese of Portland. And the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception resounds with applause and approval and thanks to God and to Pope Francis for giving the Diocese of Portland a new bishop. The rite of canonical possession continues now by Bishop Deeley being greeted by various representatives of the diocesan family, as well as representatives of ecumenical and interreligious communities here in the state of Maine. Representing the priest, the presbyterate of the Diocese of Portland, Reverend Lionel Chouinard and Father Emile Dubé, two of the faithful priests of this diocese. And then representing the deacons, permanent and transitional, Deacon Edward Clifford, studying for the priesthood at Blessed John, the 23rd National Seminary, and Deacon Dennis Popadak from the Parish of the Holy Eucharist in Yarmouth. Representing women and men of consecrated life, Sister Maureen Wallace and Brother Rex Anthony, a hermit. Bishop Deeley smiling and speaking with Sister Maureen and Brother Rex, who represent the consecrated religious of the Diocese of Portland, and representing families and family life, Scott and Michelle Valcourt and their two wonderful children, Gregory and Elizabeth. The Valcourts hail from the parish of the Ascension of the Lord in Kittery. No doubt a great honor for them to represent the families of the Diocese of Portland. And representing the young people of the diocese, religious education, Catholic schools, youth and campus ministry, Christopher from St. Brendan the Navigator Parish in Camden, Madison, who attends St. Dominic Academy in Lewiston, Auburn, Joshua from Good Shepherd Parish in Saco, and Rachel, a student at the University of Southern Maine. Bishop Deeley has always had a great commitment to young people, knows them to be not only the future, but the present of the church. And representing the good work of Catholic charities, diocesan housing, and the Catholic healthcare system here in Portland, Stephen Latourneau from Catholic Charities Maine, Helen McGinnis of the Diocesan Bureau of Housing, and Lee Miles representing St. Mary's healthcare system. And the bishop and his priests, of course, could do nothing without the lay leadership of the faithful. And so representing them, Donald Fournier of the Diocesan School Board, Greg Ginn of the Diocesan Finance Council, and Penny Laverdier of the Diocesan Pastoral Council, a former member of that board. You're watching live coverage of the massive installation for the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland, Bishop Robert P. Deeley. Bishop Deeley is being greeted now by people who represent the totality of the people of the state of Maine, and not just the Catholic community, but also representatives of Islam, Judaism, and fellow Christian communities. The Mass continues now, and we join with all of the angels of heaven in giving glory to God in the highest.
Let us pray. O God, who in each pilgrim church throughout the world make visible the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, graciously grant that your faithful may be so united to their shepherd and gathered together in the Holy Spirit through the Gospel and the Eucharist as to worthily embody the universality of your people and become a sign and instrument in the world of the presence of Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
We turn our attention to the Holy Word of God now. The first reading drawn from the book of the prophet Zephaniah will be proclaimed by Luis San Clemente. The Lord God is truly in our midst.
A reading from the book of the prophet Zephaniah. Shout for joy, O daughter Zion. Sing joyfully, O Israel. Be glad and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has removed the judgment against you. He turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You have no further misfortune to fear. On that day, it shall be said to Jerusalem, "Fear not, O Zion, be not discouraged. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty Savior. He will rejoice over you with gladness and renew you in his love. He will sing joyfully because of you, as one sings at festivals." The word of the Lord.
Two lectors for today's installation mass: Martha Corkery from All Saints Parish in Brunswick, and Luis San Clemente from St. John Vianney Parish in Fort Kent. We respond now to the first reading with Psalm 118, and our song response: "This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad." The second reading in today's installation mass is drawn from the letter to the Ephesians. To build up the body of Christ, God gives us apostles, evangelists, shepherds, teachers.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, Christ gave some as apostles, others as prophets, others as evangelists, others as pastors and teachers, to equip the holy ones for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the extent of the full stature of Christ, so that we may no longer be infants, tossed by waves and swept along by every wind of teaching arising from human trickery, from their cunning in the interest of deceitful scheming. Rather, living the truth in love, we should grow in every way into Him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, with the proper functioning of each part, brings about the body's growth and builds itself up in love. The word of the Lord.
That reading from the letter to the Ephesians contains the episcopal motto of Bishop Deeley, Veritatem facere in caritate, which translates living the truth in love. Bishop Deeley now puts incense into the thurible and will give his blessing to the deacon who today will be proclaiming the words of the gospel according to Luke, Deacon Brad Morin. He'll carry the book of the gospels in solemn procession to the ambo and proclaim the familiar story of the wealthy tax collector of Jericho, Zacchaeus. The tax collector to whose house Jesus went and stayed.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you,
Lord. At that time, Jesus came to Jericho and intended to pass through the town. Now a man there named Zacchaeus, who was a chief tax collector and also a wealthy man, was seeking to see who Jesus was, but he could not see him because of the crowd, for he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree in order to see Jesus, who was about to pass that way. When he reached the place, Jesus looked up and said, "Zacchaeus, come down quickly, for today I must stay at your house." And he came down quickly and received him with joy. When they all saw this, they began to grumble, saying, "He has gone to stay at the house of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Behold, half of my possessions, Lord, I shall give to the poor. And if I have extorted anything from anyone, I shall repay it four times over." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a descendant of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save what was lost." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The deacon will now carry the book of the Gospels to Bishop Deeley, who will reverence the words of the Holy Gospel with a kiss and bless those of us gathered here with the book of the Gospels and those of you who are watching on television and on the internet. Bishop Deeley will now deliver his first homily here at his Cathedral Church of the Immaculate Conception in Portland.
Praised be Jesus Christ. It is good for us to begin today with the name of Jesus on our lips and in our hearts. He is the center of our gathering, and he is the truth of our lives. Invoking his name becomes for us a reminder of his presence here with us on this historic day in which I am installed as the 12th Bishop of Portland. The diocese was founded in 1853, but the roots of faith, as Bishop Malone told us, gathers us together here today predate the founding of the diocese by some 250 years. The Catholic faith has been preached, confessed, and celebrated here in this beautiful land for over 400 years. Brought by the French missionaries under the sign of the Holy Cross, which now decorates the diocesan seal, it was embraced by the Native Americans who already dwelt peacefully in these lands before the explorations of English and French. Over succeeding generations, even to our own day, it has been proclaimed and confessed by the new peoples settling in this land. We are a part of a wonderful tradition which connects us to the past and sends us forward into the future to do what has been done, to proclaim the gospel. We believe that gospel is the source of joy and meaning for our lives. As I begin my service to you as the 12th shepherd, I ask once again that you pray for me as we embark together on this new chapter in the history of this grace-filled local church. Before I move too far along, I hope you'll permit me to offer a word of thanks to a few people. I am very grateful for the presence here today of Archbishop Vigano. As he told you, he made great effort to be here. He represents for us the presence of our Holy Father, Pope Francis, who has kindly made the appointment out of his pastoral concern for the people of Maine. Your Excellency, we thank you for being with us today. Please assure Pope Francis, our shepherd, a man who with his every word and gesture proclaims the gospel of joy he preaches, that we are grateful for his care for the people of Maine, and that we hold him in prayer and ask the same of him. I'm grateful as well for the presence of Sean Cardinal O'Malley and for his kindness in presiding today. Allow me also to offer my profound thanks to the 11th Bishop of Portland, Bishop Richard Malone, for his welcome here today and for his great service to this diocese over the last 10 years. Know
that you are always welcome here in Maine. I also want to welcome our 10th Bishop of Portland, Bishop Joseph Carey. Thank you for the generosity with which you have assisted Bishop Malone in these months when he was administering the diocese from afar. That means kind of beyond the 95. I am grateful as well today for the presence of my family. I would point out that we do take up a few benches. It could have been more rows, but I suggested that some of them stay home. We didn't want to take up the whole cathedral. My family is a source of a great blessing for me, and I thank you for your support and your presence. I appreciate as well today the presence of the bishops from the region and the country who have come here today and who have been able to get here. We welcome our public officials and our representatives from other churches and faith traditions who honor us with their presence today. There are many friends here today from the many different parts of my life. Many I have known in the places and communities I have been privileged to minister. I thank you all for your friendship and all the kindness you have shown me through the years. Today, I begin a whole new part of my ministry, and so I greet in a special way the priests, religious, and laity of this Diocese of Portland. I come as your new shepherd, and as Pope Francis is fond of telling bishops, I will have to get to know the smell of the sheep before I can serve you as well as the Lord Jesus calls me to. I know already of the wonderful work that is done throughout the diocese in the service of God's people. Getting to know you better will include becoming acquainted with the vast, beautiful territory and all the many roads that is the state of Maine. I have plenty of time to do that. On my trip up for the press conference in December, I came across a sign on the highway once I crossed the border from New Hampshire. It read, "Maine, worth a visit, worth a lifetime." I said to myself, well, I guess this isn't just a visit. This must be the lifetime. Though I look forward to being with you all, and I'm very grateful for your presence here today, I'm sure you will understand that I would very much like to single out our faithful priests of this diocese and the religious priests who minister alongside of them. These men serve our people so great, so generously and with such dedication. I look forward to working with them and helping them as I can as they work daily to bring the gospel to the many places in which they serve the church and particularly in our parishes. These priests, in accord with the teaching of the Second Vatican Council, are my first collaborators in the pastoral care of the diocese, and therefore an object of my special concern. These years have not been easy for priests. The grave failings of some of our number have been both a cause of shame and humiliation to the many. As well, it has not been easy to continue to preach the message of the gospel and its call to respect the dignity of the human person as created by God in an increasingly secular environment. We are so grateful for our faithful priests, for their daily acceptance of their vocation, for their fidelity to the mission the church entrusts to them, and for their continuing dedication to the people they serve. Thank you. Our gathering takes place on February 14th. You've already had your notice as to what these feasts are, but I'm sure you remember this, that this is the feast of Cyril and Methodius, the 14th of February. Perhaps you were thinking of somebody else's name, St. Valentine. Speaking of St. Valentine, I'm reminded of a time when I was working in Rome at the Vatican. I was talking with one of the women who worked with me. She had been recently married. It was this weekend, it was right around this time of year, and we had a holiday. And I asked what she had done on the holiday weekend. She told me she had visited Dublin in Ireland, where she and her new husband wanted to visit the relics of St. Valentine. Leaving Rome, La Dolce Vita and all of that, to visit Dublin for romance? And in winter? But I discovered that her reason for making such a trip was, in fact, genuine. A few hundred years ago, one of our popes gave an important set of relics of St. Valentine to an Irish priest, and they are now in a church in Dublin. St. Valentine continues to be a patron of romantic love, as witnessed by the Holy Father's gathering this morning. St. Cyril and Methodius, however, are also saints of God's love. They gathered a church in Eastern Europe. They proclaimed the message of God's love to a people that had not yet heard it. Valentine reminded us that a powerful sign of this same love of God is the commitment of man and woman in the sacrament of matrimony. As we honor these saints, we are reminded that God's love is at the heart of our gathering, for that is the message that Jesus came to proclaim, and it is the message of the gospel, the message the church is called to proclaim. We are the church. What we do today as guided by the word of God we have heard proclaimed. We gather in the communion of the church. For the first time today, you and I will hear my name included in the Eucharistic prayer. This massive installation is a good opportunity to remind us all that we are the church in Maine, and called to be supportive of each other as together we do the work of our local church. We do it in communion with one another. When you pray for me, you pray for our communion as church here in Maine. It does not mean, as Bishop Matano reminded us at his installation, that I am the only Catholic in Maine. We are the church. Our communion in the love of God is expressed in the mission we share to live out the gospel and to bring it to others. The installation of a new bishop gives us a graced opportunity to renew ourselves in this communion and this responsibility. The passage from the gospel we have heard today is the beautiful story of Zacchaeus. He is the rich but unhappy man Jesus encounters on his journey to Jerusalem, the journey which will bring him to the cross and Calvary. This gospel story is a favorite of many people, but as I reflected on it, I recalled that it was the favorite scripture passage of a priest who was very important in my life. His name was Monsignor John Kelty. He was in my parish when I was a youngster in school. He had a great influence on my life, and he encouraged me to listen to the Lord's call to enter the seminary. Later in life, years after my own ordination, I was privileged to live with him in the final years of his service as a pastor. He loved to preach on this gospel. Monsignor Kelty was a little short in stature, and he would tell how he identified with Zacchaeus, who had to climb into the tree to see Jesus coming. But as he preached, you came to know that there was another, more important reason he identified with Zacchaeus. Jesus recognized and accepted Zacchaeus, even though he was not a perfect man. In this gospel story, Monsignor Kelty himself came to know Jesus as loving him, and he was happy to bring that good news, that gospel, to others in his preaching and in his life. How many of us cannot help but see in this story of Zacchaeus the very heart of the gospel? Jesus, in his mercy and compassion, comes to be with us because of his great love for each of us. We know we are not perfect, but we are striving to live as Jesus asks of us because we have experienced his love and his compassion. The story of Zacchaeus, for Monsignor Kelty and for each of us, is a story of Jesus wanting to be with us and asking us to invite him, not only into our homes, but into our hearts. In Pope Francis' recent apostolic exhortation, The Joy of the Gospel, in which he presents for us a magnificent call to evangelize, he reminds us of something central to our faith. He says, "I never tire of repeating these words of Benedict XVI, which take us to the very heart of the gospel. Being a Christian is not the result of an ethical choice or a lofty idea, but the encounter with an event, a person, which gives life a new horizon and a decisive direction." My friends, Jesus is that person. Once we have met Jesus in this way, we too will want to share what we have come to know about him with others. As Pope Francis reminds us, that is the heart of evangelization. That is the heart of our mission. "For if we have received a love which restores meaning to our lives," says our Holy Father, "how can we fail to share that love with others?" And when we encounter Jesus and his love for us, we discover that he has a plan for each of us, a way of living that calls us to follow him, each in our own way. One author, commenting on this story of Zacchaeus, points out that Jesus' call is different as he encounters different people along the way. He changes the lives of many by letting them know of God's love for them. Zacchaeus is one of them. But notice, he is not asked to be a disciple. Nor does Jesus ask him to come and follow him on the road and be with Jesus. As far as we know, he went back to work, collecting taxes, but hopefully doing it more justly. It is a reminder to us that Jesus calls us for different tasks, but he does call each of us to know him, to experience the love he brings us, and on fire with that love to bring it to others. We are all called. We all have a vocation. God has a purpose in life for each of us. As I begin my service to you, I want to remind us all of that. We all have a responsibility to live the gospel in the way that God has chosen for us. That being said, I'd like to single out one vocation we need to work on as a church community. Monsignor Calti, out of his own experience of Jesus and his love for the church, invited me and a number of other young men in our parish to consider the possibility that we might be called to be priests. A number of us entered the seminary from our parish. Only some of us were ordained. But who knows what would have happened if no one had invited us? We need the same to be happening today. We are a church which draws its life and strength from the Eucharist. We need priests to make that possible. As we strengthen our parish communities as places of welcome, where young people can encounter Jesus, we need to engage them in conversation about what the Lord might be calling them to do with their lives. As a community in the diocese, we need to acknowledge that we need more priests. It is our responsibility, priests and laity alike, to pray and to work for an increase in vocations to priesthood and religious life. Part of that responsibility will be fulfilled in inviting our young people, and particularly our young men, to consider how they are going to respond to Jesus' call to them, and whether these young men feel God's calling them to priesthood. In my remarks at the press conference announcing my appointment, I said that I had no agenda or program, and I do not have one today either. We need to set that program together. I need to hear from you. We need to get to know each other. There will be challenges we will have to encounter. We will always need to be attentive in a particular way to those whose lives have been so hurt by the scandals which have harmed them and the church. We will continue our efforts to support the survivors and all victims of abuse. And we will continue to work to see to it that the church is a safe environment for our children. If there is to be a direction set, it will have to come from the scripture and the words of my motto from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, which we heard this afternoon, gives us a point of reference. living the truth in love. The truth for us is Jesus Christ and his message. Our response to the message of love we have received is to live that truth in charity. We witness by the love, mercy, and compassion we see in Jesus dealing with Zacchaeus. We are called in a particular way to bring that to those who suffer, and more specifically to those who are poor, marginalized, lonely, or forgotten. I know that we have many such programs, organizations, and parish outreach opportunities in this diocese. It is only right, for it is the way in which we put our faith into action. And as we serve others, even though we can experience it as a real challenge in our world today, we must continue to bear witness to the dignity of human life and every human person, from conception to natural death, the dignity of Christian marriage and the good of children so intimately part of this sacred union. It is the dignity of each person as well that grounds our special love and concern for the poor and calls us to be vigilant in the protection of religious liberty so that we can continue to advocate for the goods of human life we find grounded in reason and enshrined in the teaching of the gospel. How beautifully we continue to cherish the example and direction set for us by our Holy Father Francis in all these challenges. In all the ways in which he speaks to us, he shows us the joy that the gospel brings to his life and can bring to ours. Most recently, he had this to say in his Lenten message. The Lord asks us to be joyous heralds of his message of mercy and hope. It is thrilling to experience the joy of spreading this good news, sharing the treasure entrusted to us, consoling broken hearts, and offering hope to our brothers and sisters experiencing darkness. It means following and imitating Jesus, who sought out the poor and sinners as a shepherd lovingly seeks his lost sheep. In union with Jesus, we can courageously open up new paths of evangelization and human promotion. That, my brothers and sisters, gives us sufficient challenge for our future together. Invoking then the intercession of Mary, Mother of God, and Mother of the Church, under the title of the Immaculate Conception, to whom we will entrust ourselves today in this cathedral, which carries her name, I ask you to pray that I will be a worthy and joy-filled shepherd of you, the holy people that God has entrusted to my care, and that together we might be the community of the Church in Maine, which truly is living the truth in love, proclaiming the joy of the gospel.
Bishop Deeley delivering his first homily as the Bishop of Portland here in his cathedral church, beginning with the tagline of Vatican Radio, Laudator Jesus Christus, and ending with the invocation of Mary under the title of the Immaculate Conception, the patroness of this cathedral of the United States and the Pontifical North American College. We offer now our prayers for the church, especially this local church, for the needs of this country and our world.
And confident in God's providential love for each and every person, we now entrust to him our prayers for our church and our world.
The intercessions in the various languages represented by the people of this local church, the Diocese of Portland.
First,
in Passamon Quodi, that our Holy Father, Pope Francis, and all the bishops embody the wisdom and love of God as they humbly serve their diocese and the universal church. Speaking in Passamon Quodi, Deacon Richard Phillips Doyle of St. Kateri Parish in Calais. And now in French.
Sister Carol Martin, that Bishop
Deeley,
inspired by the eternal shepherd, be a gentle pastor, a faithful teacher and wise administrator of the Diocese of Portland. And in Arabic, Michael Augustino from the Cathedral Parish. That the leaders of nations serve the common good and promote peace and justice for all.
We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And in Spanish, Rosario Starat. That all who are called by God to be priests, deacons, vowed religious, and lay ministers respond with generous hearts.
We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And in Vietnamese,
Phan
Pham from the Cathedral Parish, that married couples and families, trusting in God's love, strengthen their commitment to each other. And speaking in Italiano, Salvatore Rea from St. Peter Parish in Portland. That those who are sick, poor, alone, or afraid, know the healing power of Christ through the compassion of our faith communities. Speaking in Polish, Malgosia Buthby from St. Louis Parish in Portland, that all gathered at this joy-filled celebration enter more deeply into the life of Christ and go forth to proclaim the good news of his love. And the final petition in English, Michael from St. Paul the Apostle Parish in Bangor.
That all our beloved dead know the joy of eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Heavenly Father, open our hearts and minds to the power of your Spirit, that we may know and accept your divine will, always living the truth with courage and in love. We ask this in the name of Jesus, the Lord.
Amen. Interpreting for the deaf and hearing impaired today, we're grateful for the services of Isabel Puccini from Holy Mater Parish in Falmouth and Heather Hansen, University of Southern Maine student interpreters for today's installation mass. As the deacons prepare the altar, the cathedral choir and members of various parish choirs sing together the beautiful Ave Verum, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart.
In
Deacon Kyle Dusteau of the Diocese of Portland, preparing the altar for the sacrifice. In attendance today, of course, Cardinal Sean O'Malley, the Metropolitan Archbishop of Boston. In an attempt to incorporate as many people from the Diocese of Portland in this beautiful celebration, the gifts, the simple gifts of bread and wine, will be brought forward and presented to Bishop Deeley today by Susan Sanders, who hails from Our Lady of the Lakes Parish, and Bernard Poirier from Holy Savior Parish in Rumford. You're watching live scenes from the Mass of Installation of the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland, Bishop Robert Deeley. In addition to those who are watching on the Eternal Word Television Network and the Catholic TV Network and online, it's great to have the many listeners on the Presence Radio Network as well. Those serving Mass today are seminarians from the Diocese of Portland, representatives of the religious communities of the diocese, and some of the young servers here at the Cathedral Parish of the Immaculate Conception. The Master of Ceremonies, standing just to the side of Bishop Deeley, Monsignor Andrew
Dubois. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Through the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
And as at the beginning of Mass, Cardinal Sean incensed the altar, so too now Bishop Deeley will incense the altar and the gifts of bread and wine that have been placed on it, and then the image of Jesus Christ crucified for us. That same sacrifice of the cross is made present here again today on this altar. The deacon will now incense Bishop Deeley, the cardinal, and the other bishops concelebrating today, the concelebrating priests, and all of the faithful who are gathered here in the Cathedral Church. During his homily, Bishop Deeley made special mention of a very fine priest, Monsignor Kelty, who was his pastor growing up and a great inspiration to him. And called for the encouragement and prayer for vocations to the priesthood.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, the praise of the Lord, and the church.
Celebrating the memorial of your Son's boundless love, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that through the ministry of your church, the fruits of his saving work may advance the salvation of all the world. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is truly right and just,
our duty and our salvation. Always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people, formed as one by the unity of the Trinity, made the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit, might, to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the Church. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Jesus Christ, your Son, and our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant, Francis our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, and all those who holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith.
Remember, Lord, your servant, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them, we offer you the sacrifice of praise, and they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious Ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things,
we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hand, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took his precious chalice in his holy and venerable hand, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
Your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them and bestow them upon us.
O God, my Father, in the
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
You're watching our continuing presentation of the Mass of Installation for the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland in Maine, Bishop Robert Deeley, live from the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception.
Thank you.
The choir of the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception sings the familiar, "We hold the death of the Lord in our hearts," composed by David Haas, and reminiscent of the words of Bishop Deeley in his homily today. We are the church. What we do today as we celebrate the Eucharist is to pray that we will be more the church, more what the Lord calls us to be. This massive installation is a great opportunity to remind us all that we are the church. Here specifically, the church in Maine, called to be supportive of each other as together we do the work of the Lord, in communion with one another, and in communion with the new Bishop of Portland, Bishop Robert Deeley. We hold the death of the Lord deep in our hearts.
We must die with the Lord. We hold the death of the Lord deep in our
hearts. One of the most intimate acts of the priest or the bishop is to distribute Holy Communion, to give the Lord Jesus to those whom he serves. For those of you who are watching on television, on the internet, listening on radio, please know you are in communion with us spiritually at this moment as we receive the body and the blood of the crucified and risen Lord here at the Cathedral Church of the Immaculate Conception in Portland.
Oh,
the beautiful music today at this installation mass being provided by the Cathedral Choir here at the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception in Portland and members of various parish choirs from throughout the Diocese of Portland. To be the bishop of a diocese is to exercise constancy and courage and fidelity, to preside in charity over a local church. And so Bishop Deeley begins his ministry.
I invite you now to stand.
By a special prayer of entrustment.
And together let us pray this act of entrustment to Mary, the Mother of the Church, and our Mother. We come before you, Mary, Mother of the Church, and our Mother, asking you to place under your protective mantle this local church of the Diocese of Portland.
Like you, the Church's first and most perfect member, we too stand at the foot of the cross as witnesses to what human sinfulness is capable of inflicting on the body of Christ. With you, we also know the joy of the resurrection. Obtain for us new ardor and courage in bearing witness to Christ and to his victory over sin and death. Watch over us all, clergy, religious, and laity, with maternal care, so that, as members of one family of faith, our bonds of communion may grow stronger, our love for one another deeper, the practice of our faith more devout, and our witness to Christ more heroic, for the sake of our mission to be salt and light for the world. We entrust our diocese to you, Mary, Mother of God, and star of the new evangelization.
Let us pray. In this your church, O Lord, may integrity of faith, holiness of life, fraternal charity, and pure religion flourish and abide until the end. And as you do not fail to feed her with the body of your Son and with your word, so also never cease, we pray, to guide her under your protection through Christ our Lord. Before we conclude this part of our celebration today, I would like to take a moment just to offer some thanks to those who have worked so hard to make this such a beautiful ceremony and to gather together all that has happened during these days, weather permitting. Of course, Sister Rita Mae Bissonnette and Monsignor Andrew Dubois oversaw the whole process with the help of so many people. Sister Rita Mae was the chair of the committee and the arrangements, and Monsignor Dubois did the liturgy and all the oversight and organization involved with that. We're so grateful for that. We're grateful for everyone here who helped in the liturgy, the service, the seminarians, the religious from the diocese, and the faithful cathedral service as well, the readers, the gift bearers, and all who participated in this liturgy, and those who had made the great plans for the Vespers yesterday and who were ready to participate, but snow. It's Maine. Suzanne Proulx has done a beautiful job of organizing the music and the choir. We're very grateful to her and to the choir. They've done a wonderful job enhancing our liturgy and helping us to pray in song. I'm grateful as well to all the committee, including the many people at Chancery, who have worked hard over these past months to get everything right. Everyone cooperated except Mother Nature. And finally, my thanks to Father Lou Phillips, rector of the cathedral, who is so gracious in his hospitality and all who assist him in this cathedral parish who have been most kind and welcoming. I thank you. Father Lou was telling me the other night that he had a temporary worker here who was helping out here, and he told him that it was for, we were doing things for, because we had to install a bishop. And the worker asked him, well, what's a bishop and what tool will I need to install it? Just your love.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
And may Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
And so ends, as Bishop Deeley said, this part of the celebration, the solemn mass of installation for the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland. The Cathedral Choir leads us now in Psalm 84, Oh, How Amiable. My soul hath a desire and longing to enter into the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God. Thank you for joining us for this solemn mass of installation, celebrating the commencement of the ministry of Bishop Robert Deeley as the 12th Bishop of the Diocese of Portland. Please do keep Bishop Deeley and the people of Portland in your good prayers as together they begin this new chapter in their journey of faith. To all those joining us on the Catholic TV Network, the Eternal Word Television Network, the Presence Radio Network, and online at the website for the Diocese of Portland, we are grateful for your viewership and support. I'm Father Reed, and from all of us here at the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception in snowy Portland, Maine, we sincerely wish you God's blessings, God's strength, and God's peace today and always.
O God, Lord of heaven and earth, you alone have accomplished all we have done. May this first Catholic satellite television network be a tribute to the beauty of your church. May your Son, the Eternal Word, be glorified through this work of your hands. Bless all the programs that will issue forth from its facilities. Just as your word issued forth from you, Lord Father, may that same word touch each heart that listens to this network. Let your Spirit work with freedom through every teacher who proclaims your truth and your church. Bestow upon this network the power to inspire men to seek holiness of heart, zeal for the extension of your church, courage to seek after justice and human rights, and patience to endure persecution. Amen.
You're watching EWTN's Faith Factory. It's geared for kids.